Hello guys, my name is Jaideep Marathe. I'm the director of business development at our company Simplicity Investing. We are financial advisors based in Pune, and today I'm here to talk about wealth creation or wealth management in the 21st century. So we all talk about living in the 21st century and how technology is driving the change, how global companies like Microsoft, Facebook, Amazon, Apple, Google are changing the way we live. But what we've observed over the last two and a half years that we've been into this investment advisory field is most Indians, we still invest the way how our parents used to invest in the 20th century. We love physical assets like real estate, gold. We invest in insurance as a, we look at insurance as an investment, and we invest in a very, very different way. This is not the way that we should be ideally investing in 21st century. So through this presentation, we are just here to broaden your perspective, broaden your outlook on what you should be focusing on when you're investing. So that's going to be the agenda today. We're not here to sell any product. We're not here to sell our services. This is pure knowledge sharing, and I do hope that you like what we are telling you. So to begin with, this is a very important slide, and we always start with this slide. So the big picture in life is to achieve growth and happiness. A lot of people, when they're working, when they're earning money, they lose track of what is important in life. We've seen a lot of rich people running after money and they sometimes forget to enjoy the fruits of life. They sometimes forget to enjoy the money that they have made, and they just focused on earning more money by investing in stocks or real estate or whatever their assets are, and they're completely focused there. So it's very important, whatever activity we do, business or investments, the ultimate objective is to help our family grow and to make keep us happy. So that's very important. Now the first few slides are generic, but they are, I would say, a precursor, or maybe it's something that will create a story for the presentation that we are about to do. So what has changed in the last 50 years or last 20 years? We used to have this kind of big televisions, very few channels, very few options. Then came the flatrons. Of course, the flatrons lasted not a long time, and then eventually everything moved to the mobile. Today almost everything is done through the mobile, be it banking, watching cinema, interacting with friends, family. Everything is done through a mobile phone. Unfortunately, like I said, we are still investing the old way. We are not investing in new technologies. We are not investing in new businesses. Business models are changing substantially. Another important aspect that has changed in the last few years, probably one or two generations, is earlier everyone used to live in joint families. Then came the nuclear families, couple and maybe two kids living together. Today we have started having global families. Parents living in India, kids living abroad, kids have citizenship there, for foreign country they'll probably never move back. The family structure affects investments and how investment patterns or how investments are done in a country in a big way, big, big way. Now imagine a family whose kids are living abroad and they're never going to come back to India. If that family owns a lot of real estate in India, they're going to find it extremely difficult to manage it once the parents, while probably living in India, decide to move abroad. So you go to Prabhat Road, at least in every building you will have 20 to 30% families whose kids are abroad and they're never going to come to India. So all of that eventually is going to come into the market, because the parents would eventually want to sell and settle in US or UK, wherever their kids are. So investments to a large extent are driven by family structures. This is US, this has already happened in US. Only 25% of US families are married and they have their own kids. Everything else are completely, extremely different, and combinations. husband, wife, maybe just staying together, maybe they are not even married, kids from first marriage or kids from first as from someone else, so all of that structure. Now imagine if a couple living together in the US own a property and they have a divorce, or they start to live, or they decide to live separately, they'll always have problems with separating a real estate, because separating real estate is impossible, a flat or a bungalow. But if you have financial assets, it's very easy, you can just split it 50-50. So family structures is affecting investments all around the world. It's soon going to affect India. The learning age is going up because you have to be a expert. Earlier you could be a graduate and you could get a very good job. The earning age is coming down because technology soon makes us obsolete. Probably in our generation, we'll probably have to retire at the age of 45-50. And the spending age is going up because medical science has advanced substantially in the last few years, and it's going to do it's going to advance even further in the next 20-25 years. So the life expectancy is expected to go to 100 in certain cases. So we have to save for a longer time. So we cannot afford to make any mistakes when we are starting out with our careers, or starting when we are doing our first investments. We need to make the least mistakes. So we always say that whoever makes the least mistakes will be the most successful investor. Another changing pattern that we've seen, or we will soon observe, is between Indian women. Currently, Indian women prefer to invest in diamond, gold, cash. American women, or some of the independent Indian women, invest in mutual funds. Why? Because again, family structures, you cannot be dependent on your father or your husband for financial freedom or financial independence. You have to do that yourselves. So the focus on mutual funds or financial assets is going to go up, similarly to what has happened in the United States. Of course, this won't happen immediately, this will happen over a period of time, but we have already starting this change in urban women, especially preferring to invest their own money in financial assets rather than typical assets like gold and diamond. So this change is already there. Now, when we come to financial planning, this is a very important goal. We usually start working at the age of 25. We retire at the age of 65. This is what we are hoping for, to continue. So when we are starting out with the career, we don't have any savings. Our entire 100% income is from our business or our profession or salary. So everything is from our active income. The ultimate objective is, by the time we retire, we should have replaced our active income with passive income. Passive income meaning income from investments, income from rentals, or any other source of income. So once we do this, we achieve financial freedom for our retirement, because retirement is the ultimate goal. We live in a generation where our kids probably won't take care of us. We'll have to do it ourselves. So that's the unfortunate reality which we'll probably have to face. So we have to plan for our own retirement, and that's the ultimate goal of financial planning today. So this is very important. Now, whenever we are investing, or if you observe investments or any activity for that matter, you'll see that there are either events and then there are trends. Now, 99% of the people focus on events, 1% people focus on trends. Now, if we associate this with investments, this is what we come to. So what are events? Elections, war, natural calamities, change of leaders are all events. Now, these events happen at regular intervals. We have had elections in India in the last 70 years. We've had wars, global wars. We've had natural calamities. We've had change of leaders. So these are all events, and a lot of people focus heavily on such events, and they base their investment decisions on what might happen in the election or what has happened in the election. However, to tell you honestly, these events don't impact your investments in a big way. They affect you in the short term, and this short term volatility, if you see, during any of these events is actually an opportunity for a long-term investor. We've had elections in the last 70 years, but that has not stopped the progress of this country. So it's way beyond that. Now, what affects our lives or what affects our investments in a far bigger way, or things which have far bigger impact on our lives, is innovation of new technologies. Today, everything has gone mobile. We use WhatsApp, Instagram, Facebook to reach to our customers or to talk to our clients. Demographic changes. So a country's population, the age mix is extremely important. So to give you an example, India is a 27-year-old country, meaning the average age of India is 27, the average age of Japan is 47. So India is a 27-year-old person, Japan is a 47-year-old person. When you're 27, you have a lot of aspirations. Marriage, you want to spend on fashion, entertainment, buy a car, two-wheeler, all sorts of activities. You have energy and you have aspirations. When you're 47, the priorities are extremely different, or completely different. The priorities is your children's education, your health, your retirement. Those are the priorities. Also, most of the people need money when they are 27. At 47, you already have excess money. So that's the reason why Japan has negative interest rates. It has nothing to do with the government. The fact that there are more depositors in Japan and less borrowers, because when you're old, you don't want to take risk, you don't want to borrow. So they have more depositors, less borrowers. So that's the reason why a Japanese bank will charge you interest for taking care of your money. Whereas in India, we are 27, there are less number of depositors at 27. We have just started out with our career, and we have, of course, a lot of spending needs. So there are less number of depositors and more number of borrowers. That's why in India we have interest rates of 8 to 10%, or maybe even more. Also, another important aspect is migration of population from rural to urban places, increase in longevity and life. We've touched this topic again. Changes in family structures, Walmart, IKEA coming to India. So these are the long-term trends, and these are the trends that affect an economy. These are the trends that affect our investments, even our businesses, in a big way. So we have to focus here. This is extremely important. And there could be many more trends, which of course we haven't talked about, but that's what we have to focus on. So only 1% of the people invest based on trends. And those are the 1% people who actually succeed, because this is the future. An event is something that has already happened in the past. So the long-term influencing factors on our business is, of course, technology. We cannot live without technology. We cannot live without Microsoft, Google, Apple today. Demographic changes, again, but demographics, like I just gave you the example about India and Japan. So demographics plays a very critical role. Global trends are extremely important. But politicians, now in our opinion, politicians can only act as facilitators. Today, politicians are not driving the change. Technology is driving the change. Politicians are in fact having to adapt themselves to use technology to the fullest. So the classic example is of Donald Trump or Narendra Modi, who have used Twitter for their benefit. And they are directly communicating with their voters through technology. So they are not changing technology. Technology is changing them. So politicians can only act as facilitators. Media, in our opinion, gets negative marks, because today, unfortunately, most of the media is there to sensationalize news. It's all negative. There's nothing positive that comes out of there. So we avoid reading newspapers, and we avoid watching news channels, because that doesn't help in investments, especially. Irrespective of whether we are managing our business, our family, or our investments, there are always four parts to it. So if we talk about investments, we have the product, we have the process, we have the behavior, and we have the market. Out of these four, every part gets equal percentage. Of course, it's equally important. So identifying the product, setting a systematic process of investing and keeping a check on our behavior/emotions is within our control. The market cycle is beyond our control. We cannot control the market. The market is like a ocean. I mean, we cannot control the ocean. All we can do is navigate. But if we identify quality products, if we follow a very solid process, we stick to it, we invest systematically, and we keep a check on our behavior, because there are a lot of distractions. The media, your friends, family will tell you different things every day. You'll get confused, and we've seen people destroying their portfolios. So if we manage to keep a check, select a quality product, identify and follow a very good process of investing systematically, looking at your cash flows and keeping a check on our behavior or emotions, we can navigate through any market cycle, irrespective of whether the markets are doing bad or they're doing good. We can navigate and build a portfolio which takes care of our family goals or financial goals, so as to say. So that's very much possible. So now I come to the very, specific topic. So what has technology done to human lives? So it took us 10,000 years to reach a population of 1 billion. And then there has been a one-way street. If you see these small blips, this is because of maybe a Spanish flu or World War I and World War II. Now, why has this happened? Because technology has affected the most in healthcare. Earlier, there used to be, the life expectancy was small. Infant mortality was extremely high. Now, all of that has changed. And that's the reason why there has been a one-way street. Production has went up. Production of food, everything has gone up, so that has helped. So the biggest impact of technology has been on the human population. Over the last 12,000 years, we haven't seen this kind of a growth. Now, what happens in an internet minute? A company like Uber in 2016 used to book 1,300 rides. Today it books 3,800. 2017 it booked 3,800 rides. I'm sure by today they are doing much more. Google, 2.4 million searches, 3.5 million searches. So none of these companies have assets, right? Uber doesn't own any of the taxis. They don't employ the drivers. They're just a software, and they provide us the service. So it's an asset light model. So what technology has done is it has made assets redundant in certain extent, and you don't have to own an asset to build a solid business. So, and in fact, these companies are growing at a phenomenal pace. So 1300 to 3800, that's a huge jump. So what they have shown is you don't have to actually own assets. So going asset light is what most of the businesses are aiming for. And if you invest in these kind of businesses, you should do very well, because the risks are low. If you look at technology in the Indian context, the classic case of HDFC Bank comes to mind. HDFC today only accounts for 5% market share. The public sector banks, all of them put together, account for 70% market share in India's organized banking. But the market capitalization of HDFC is 7.5 lakh crores, probably 7 lakh crores. The market capitalization of all 22, 23 public sector banks put together is about 4.5 lakh crores. Now, why has this happened? Again, because of technology. HDFC is leveraged technology. They have leveraged their brand. They have created a world-class brand. They have strong processes, management ethics, and they have a vision. They have drive to grow and become number one in India. So that's the reason why FFIs have been consistently investing in this company, and this company has also outperformed. Indian public sector banks have some of the highest NPAs in the world. So that's how big the effect of technology is. Now we come to another important aspect again, which is demographic. So there are different parts to demographic segmentation. Now how demographics has affected economics and valuations. The world population in 1850 was 1.2 billion. India's population in 2018 is 1.3 billion. So there's been an exponential jump. In fact, India's population has gone up from 20 to 23 crores in 100 years back to 1.4 billion today. So there's been a 7 times jump that has resulted in a substantial increase in real estate prices, because more people were there. Give you a classic example of how demographics affects an economy. This is Japanese population. the dark blue is under 15, red is 15 to 65, which you can say is the working population, and light blue is over 65 is senior citizens. So this was Japan in 1950s, very few senior citizens, a high number of kids, and of course a good number of working population. So their working population and the number of kids consistently went up right until the year 1995. So year 1995 was a year when two things happened for Japan. Their working population peaked, and also the population of the under 15 was until 1995 more than the population of over 65, that is senior citizens. If you see the 2000 chart, there's a small dip in the working population, as well as the senior citizens population went above the population of the kids. So 1995 was the peak of the Japanese population. Also, the peak of the Japanese stock market was in the year 1992, because of course the stock markets always function in advance to an economy, because if they expect the economy to do well, they'll start investing today. If they expect the economy not to do well, they'll start dumping the shares, and then the markets will crash. So the peak of the Japanese stock market till date has been in the year 1992. Subsequently, they have never reached what they did in the year 1992. They came close last year, but again they have now corrected. I mean, this was probably 26,000. They came close. I don't know if they exceeded that 26,000, but subsequently they have again come down to 20. Now this has happened, of course, because more senior citizens who consume less products and services, a smaller working population, because this population has to pay the taxes which support the senior citizens, and less number of kids. So population has permanently affected the Japanese stock market or Japanese economy. So if we look at the classic case of China, what China has done, a lot of people in India still talk about how China implemented the one child policy in the 1970s, because they realized that the population had grown exponentially. However, what people don't talk about is a few years ago, a couple of years ago, they went away with that policy. They in fact asked the citizens to produce more, because 2015, this is the pyramid that they have, still a high number of working people and high number of kids. But they realized that by 2050, the pyramid is going to tilt, and then it can fall either side. So they realized that they'll have a lot of senior citizens. And that's the reason why they said that we need to have more kids, and that's why they asked their citizens to produce more. So even countries focus on demographics, it's very important. Now if you look at industry specific and how demographics affects healthcare industry, this is the expense, this is the age. As the age goes up, healthcare expenses go up. Today India is 27, we are just here, we have to go all this way. So that's the reason why we Indians spend hardly anything on healthcare. In fact, we spend, I think India spends about $80 per person. America spends $8,000. Now America is extreme, India is extreme on the lower end. China spends $300 to $400 per person per annum, because they are a 35-year-old country. So slowly and steadily, as the country ages, as India ages, our expenses, our healthcare expenses will go up. So this is a recession-proof industry in our lifetime. That's one of the reasons why a lot of big businesses are interested in investing in this industry. Now, what we have also observed in India, or anywhere for that matter, when individual investors invest, they first look at a product. I mean, they look at if they want to invest, buy shares, they'll buy analyze a company. If they want to buy a property, they'll analyze the property, or if they want to invest in a mutual fund, they'll look at a mutual fund. What they fail to do is all of this. What is far more important is firstly to identify what's happening around the world. A classic case of this is 2008 financial crisis. The financial crisis in 2008 had nothing to do with India. It was a financial fraud or whatever mismanagement that happened in the United States. It was a subprime crisis and the housing bubble and all of that stuff. It had nothing to do with India, or for that matter most of the world economy. But when there was a correction in once Lehman Brothers collapsed, we could see the impact of the collapse of Lehman Brothers on the entire world economy. The American stock market corrected from 16,000 to 8,000. Indian markets corrected from 21 to 8,000. So in fact, India had a far bigger correction. So what's important is to get the global macro right. What's happening around the world, that's far more important. Then it's important to analyze your country. So if you are investing in India, we have to look at how interest rates, whether global interest rates are positive for us, whether oil is good, oil is in within the range, because these kind of things affects the macro and the macro planning also. So we have to first focus on the global macro, then we have to focus on the country macro, then we have to look at an industry, and then we have to finally select a fund or a stock. This is extremely important. So the example that we always give is the best company in the worst sector will probably give you less returns than the worst company in the best sector. So if the sector is very good and you select maybe a fifth or a sixth company, sixth best company, it will still give you better returns than in an industry which is not doing well or which is expected not to do well, and you select the number one company in that sector. So it's very important to first do our homework and then identify a company or an investment. So this is extremely important. Focus on global macro, focus on country macro. Also, another thing, what is happening today and what is actually throwing off the traditional methods of valuations is technology. Again, there are some companies which are growing this way. These companies are leveraging technology. Amazon is a classic example. Then there are traditional businesses who don't have the ability or don't have the depth to invest in technology or understand technology, and they are growing this way. So that's the reason for this kind of a valuation gap. And a lot of people today talk about, oh, this company has a very high PE ratio and all of that. But the reason why they have a high PE ratio is because this company is leveraging technology and capturing markets all around the world or all around the country. So what is likely to happen as a result of technology, demographics and global trends is, this is what India's asset allocation is. We prefer physical assets, 35% in financial assets. The global standards is 65% in financial assets and 35% in real estate or physical assets. So India eventually, as a result of, again, globalization, technology, family structure changing, trends like life expectancy, all of this, we're going to prefer more to invest in financial assets. So this is going to happen. If you look at India's balance sheet today, we have 54% of our assets in real estate, 11% gold, 30% in other financial assets, bank deposits, insurance, PPF, cash, 5% in equity and equity mutual funds. So our love for gold probably will continue. So we'll still be there at maybe 8 to 10%. Financial assets, yes, it will continue. We have huge amounts of bank deposits. Insurance will play big role. We'll have PPF and cash and some other assets. So we'll continue probably at 30. However, the big flow is now going to come from real estate into financial assets, because real estate, of course, is not, we don't expect real estate to do exceedingly well as an asset class. Equities should do well. And also what is important is amongst equities, it won't be like a broad-based rally that we've seen in the last 25 years. Today, the differentiation between a good company, a bad company, or a good management and a bad management is vast. Only good companies are expected to do well. So but that flow is going to happen from real estate to the stock market. So why don't we expect, why we say that real estate won't do well? Again, India, world population 1.2 billion, India's population 1.4 billion today. India's witnessed a 400% jump. This is the world population. India's chart is very similar. So this is the age, this is the number of people. The first time you buy a property for consumption, you're buying it in the age of 20 to 40. So that's where the biggest consumption is. After 40, most of the time, a person buys a property as an investor, and after 60, you're sellers. Again, for obvious reasons that you don't want to sit on properties, who will manage the properties. So this is the world population as well as India's population is extremely similar, demographics. So we have a still a large flow. We have a good consumer. I mean, we have large number of consumers. We have good number of people who are going to become consumers. However, this is what is going to happen in the next 30 years. Less number of kids, a decent number of consumers, but very high number of investors and very high number of sellers. So this is going to bring in a lot of supply, and this is going to keep the real estate prices low. That's going to happen. Also, what America witnessed in 2008, India is witnessing that today. So 2018 is probably 2008 of India. But however, what happened in the United States, once they realized that there was a bubble in the housing markets, that bubble burst, prices were corrected by anywhere between 20 to maybe 70-80%. However, companies declared bankruptcy. However, they started working again. The economy functioned, and for 10 years they've had prosperity. Whereas in India, the prices haven't gone down. People are still waiting. People are still hoping for the prices to recover, and so that they can make the money that they made probably in 2004 to 2012 period. However, what has happened is prices haven't moved. There's an opportunity cost of 10% every year. So you have already lost 40% on a property. Builders have gone bankrupt. They have affected their vendors. They have affected banks, financial institutions who have lent to them. And so this is like a heart attack. A person dies after 15 days, the family is back working. This is like a paralysis attack. It affects the family. It affects the financials, everything. Nothing moves. Everything is stuck. So this is what has happened to India. So it will take a long time for this correction to happen. Of course, whether the real estate market will go up? Yes, there's a possibility of real estate market going up. But what will happen is, first, stock prices would go up, because like I said, stock prices are always in advance to an economic cycle. So first, corporate earnings have to go up. Before corporate earnings come, stock prices move up. So a certain part of this corporate earnings go in salaries. Companies recruit more, they give higher salaries. Then affordability will have to come into real estate, and then the real estate prices will go up. So it's like the stock market is the first train to leave the station, and real estate is the last train to leave the station. So you'll have to decide where do you want to invest. How asset classes have performed? The best. So we took an average of the best equity mutual fund and the worst equity mutual fund from 1995 till, this was probably 2017-18, sorry. So 29 times returns. Real estate has given 6 to 10. This is a property in the center of the city. We don't consider real estate like land, agricultural land. In some cases they have gone up by 100%, but similar has been the case where maybe a 30 rupee share of HDFC has gone to, I don't know, 30,000, 35,000. If you consider all the bonus and the dividends that they have declared. So there are cases everywhere. Now, what is very important? A lot of people ask us this question, that why do we need an advisor? We explain them this. Why, we have multiple examples. So one such example is, of course, that of Roger Federer. So Roger Federer, in my opinion, is the greatest tennis player of all time. However, even he has a coach who tells him how to play tennis, or what corrections he needs to do, or what improvements he needs to do. So you always need someone to debate, discuss. You always need someone to tell you no when there's something when you want to do something. You always need someone to tell you yes when you're afraid to do some things which are in your interest, actually. So an advisor or a coach is extremely helpful if you want to play professionally. Like I said, you cannot afford to make any mistakes. So you need someone to keep your emotions in check, your behavior in check, to identify the right product for you, to set a right process for you, and make sure that you follow that process. That's very important. And of course, emotions. I mean, you'll have a lot of distractions from media, from your friends, family, giving you advice. So it's very important to stay focused, and that's where an advisor is important. Now, a small slide about what we do and how we work. So we have our head office in Pune. We have a branch office in Mumbai and Aurangabad. Currently, we have a team of 11 spread across all three locations. 150 crores plus is what we manage, and we work with about 650 families. How we work, we first understand the profile, the family profile. It's not a, so then we identify the vision and strategy? I mean, what is it that the family intends to achieve? What's going to be their family profile? Then considering the cash flows and the income and etc. etc., we set a process of systematic investment in the best 100 companies in India and US. So there are ways in which we can also invest in the US markets, companies like Facebook, Amazon, Apple, Boeing, Lockheed Martin, we can invest there. We also help families get their macro asset allocation right. What should be in real estate, what should be in physical asset, what should be in financial assets. In financial assets, what should be focused towards growth like equities, what should be focused on safety like deposits and debt mutual funds. Then there is, of course, the continuous flow of information. Whatever knowledge we gain through our research and our development, we share that with the knowledge, and it's throughout the financial journey. So it's not a one-time activity that we do and the investments are done and then bye-bye. It's not that way. We also work with complete transparency. Of course, this you'll come to know, I mean, if you start working with us. And then, of course, we try and use technology the maximum. This is something 99% of Indian investors are not aware about, that we are consuming these products. All of us, we consume these products, but we are not investing in them. These are all global brands, international brands. They have spread themselves across the world, but we are not investing in these companies. There are options to do that, but 99.9% of the people don't do that. In fact, that's actual statistics. 99.9% of India's money is invested in India. We don't invest abroad, whereas an American investor, in spite of having such companies, would invest 80% in their home markets and 20% outside America. Now this, I come to the final slide of our presentation. This is the Taj Mahal built by Shah Jahan, original design, best quality material, artisans, etc. etc. Even after 400 years, this is giving us returns. Every foreigner who comes to India wants to visit the Taj Mahal. Taj Mahal is extremely popular across the world, whereas his son Aurangzeb built the Bibi Ka Maqbara in Aurangabad. Most of the Indians also don't know that such a monument exists. He used subpar quality, copied his father's model, not an original design, went for cheap stuff, and this is what it is today. So if you are investing, make sure that you invest like Shah Jahan. You invest in quality. Quality is not costly, quality is priceless. But go for quality, because quality stuff helps you, or always gives you returns, and your kids or your descendants should be happy that you have done something like this, rather than given them a Bibi Ka Maqbara. So that's very important. Now I thank you for attending this webinar. So if you like this, please like, share, subscribe our LinkedIn, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter and YouTube channel for more information, and you can get in touch anytime you need any help. Thank you.